works is in private collections in London, South Africa, United States, and Singapore. And so she can be in your collection soon. So at this point, allow me to introduce and give her the floor.
Hi everyone, I'd like to thank you all very much for coming. Some of you will know that I'm Durban born, and having an exhibition here 25 years after I left is a great privilege and means a great deal to me. The title I gave this exhibition is Tajectory. The dictionary gives this definition, and I quote, "The path described by an object moving in air or space under the influence of such forces as thrust, wind resistance, and gravity." It seems to me that I am this moving object, thrust through time and space, under the influence of various internal and external forces pushing against me and propelling me forward. And all these forces have conspired to lead me here to this place, this moment, and I'm very grateful and happy that they have. One very obvious observation to make about paintings is that they don't move. Once made, they remain unchanged. My world within me and around me is in constant flux, but once I've made a painting, it remains unchanged, and there's something simultaneously comforting and frightening about that. There's a story about a discussion between the critic Harold Rosenberg and the artist Philip Guston. And Rosenberg asked Guston, "What's it like when you go to the studio?" And Guston said that he was reminded of something that the artist and composer John Cage had said, and I quote, "The studio is full of other people, and as you begin to paint, the people begin to leave one by one. And if you're really lucky, you leave." There's something so exquisitely true about this. When painting, the ideal state is not to be thinking, to not be self-conscious. In a sense, the mind is led by the body. Painting is first and foremost an activity. The idea is not enough. It needs to be transformed, and it's the transformation that counts. Painting directs me as much as I direct it. It's as much about reacting as acting, and as much about what I invent as what I find. The curator Kurt Vonnegut wrote somewhere that the narrow intention of what brings an artist to the canvas does not control meaning nearly as much as does the material existence of the picture itself. And I very much agree with this. And it brings me to the question of language. So much of contemporary art is word-bound. There seems to be a kind of skepticism in relation to visual perception. Language and text have become, in large part, the main means of content delivery in contemporary art, much of contemporary art. I think that there are places and pictures where the linguistic model stops making sense and becomes counterintuitive. What gets lost in amongst all the theories and interpretations is the picture as the picture. Adam Phillips, the psychoanalyst and writer, once wrote that because self-knowledge is always a reconstruction, it's always out of date. One could argue that explanations about one's work presents a similar problem. It seems that the appearance of a work is often distrusted, especially if the image favors beauty over content, or beauty as content. We become almost embarrassed about beauty in contemporary art. As Gerard Richter, the artist, says, beauty is out of fashion. We don't need it, we need entertainment. Art is also increasingly come to be seen as something which must contain some kind of virtue, must instruct us or educate us. It must have some pet message, be it political or social or intellectual. It must carry some progressive commentary. Although it may be laudable to think about what is important to address within society, it's so common to find the experience to be an impoverished one because the intention is very hard to manifest successfully. The viewer tries to qualify the experience with the claims made for it by the artist and is often left lacking, in my opinion. I'm drawn to more to less intention and more emphasis on the process and where that will take me, both as a maker of art and as a viewer of it. My paintings don't point to anything else other than their own concrete form. Painting is, after all, only anything at all because of how it looks. I don't want definitive answers. I don't even want definitive questions. I want a bit of mystery, a bit of the unknown and the unknowable, and for the hidden to be only partially revealed. The painter, de Kooning, said, and I quote, "Content, if you want to say, is a glimpse of something, an encounter, you know, like a flash. It's very tiny, very tiny." I think that there are places where language no longer serves as an adequate medium of expression because there are experiences which are felt, at least to me, to lie outside of language. There's a person before language. Perhaps this is what makes me a painter rather than a writer. Why I paint what I paint is mostly a mystery, and if it were to be analyzed as with ourselves, it would forever evade complete mastery of understanding. My work is about color, shape, texture, form, and composition. Some may need a painting to perform as a narrative space or for it to contain a meaning they can grasp. Meaning is to be found at all in my paintings. It belongs with the projection of the viewer and is out of my control. However, my paintings may not contain any overt narrative or personal story, but I am there. I'm there in that frenzied smear of Windsor yellow. I'm there in that translucent wash of Davy's grey. I'm there in that precise, controlled mark and in that frenzied accident. I am those awkward, tangled lines and that bright blue, cerulean smudge. And this brings me finally to something that the painter Frank Auerbach said, and I quote, "I think that the unity in any painter's work is because people, when brought to a desperate situation, behave in a certain way. And that is what real style is. It's how one behaves in a crisis. End quote. With painting, as with other things in life, you're always losing possibilities by the choices you make. And I think that's a very exciting thing. Thank you all for coming.